Tail end of the show, but I did not invite any boring speakers to this event. And for those of you that still have the stamina to listen to another talk, you're in for quite a treat. I have actually known Justin Credabel for a really long time. Yeah, met at IMAC in Chicago for one of his first presentations. It was kind of this crazy, eccentric, choral guy with a lot of funky ideas. And, you know, I considered him as a speaker for MACNA, and I was thinking to myself, it's like, I love Justin, but he can't stay focused on a topic for more than 5 minutes. And so then a little bit later on, I was like, oh man, Justin would be a great speaker to talk about a handful of semi-esoteric things for 5 minutes at a time. So instead of diving deep into one topic for 30 minutes, he's gonna give us a little trivia talk on six different topics for 5 minutes. And I think you're gonna hear about some things that you didn't even know existed, but things that are really an important part of our reef aquarium. So please help me in welcoming the one and only, Justin Credabel.
Yeah, thanks Jake for having me. It's been a fun MACNA. And all right, here I'm just gonna blow through a lot of stuff here. Hi Denver, this is me. I got a cute family. I like to play rock and roll and music. I have a company called Reef Gen, started up a couple years ago. We are wholesale, we grow fish and corals and stuff like that. This is my lovely business partner, Laura Bierenbaum. Here's Joe Aiello, the illustrious giant coral tank growing guy. Everyone knows who he is. His beautiful tank, it also is beautiful tank, beautiful fish. Cuttlefish, we're really proud of them. They're really cool, they're at Live Aquaria. Grafting, all right, so this is the first topic. Bam, I'm 30 seconds into it. So. I was into grafting ever since I was a little kid, and I started with plants and flowers. And we've been doing grafting as humans since the dawn of agriculture. Is it that boring already? This is fascinating grafting. They do a lot with apples, or if you have damage to the branch, you can actually take the tissue and kind of go over damaged areas. Pretty neat stuff there, just wacky. We do grafting in people. They call it tissue transplants or you know, kidney transplant. That's grafting. You do it with hands now. You know, it's a little weird looking, but hey, it's better to have a couple hands. Sometimes it doesn't work out so well. That's tissue rejection there. So sometimes that happens with coral. Sometimes it happens with hands. So fusion, there's three different main groups of fusion. The isogenic fusion is fusion to oneself. So a clone, you can fuse clones together. Like if you have acropora, you get a whole bunch of different ones from the same mother colony, they'll become one again. That's isogenic. Allogenic fusion, fusion of the same species. So that's organ transplantation, stuff like that. That's allogenic fusion. That's another individual putting their organ in somebody else, or putting two different corals of the same species together, but just two different lines. That's an allogenic fusion. Then there's xenogenic fusion, fusion between different species, and this does happen all the time too, and we're working on medicine to make that happen so that we can use pig hearts and all kinds of other organs like that. So sometimes, if we first started looking at fusion, they first noticed it in hydrozoans and stuff like that. A bunch of work was done in the Philippines by these great guys, worked with Possilopora and Styliphora, Ceratopora, and they were doing very controlled experiments with getting things to fuse. So what happens when you graft, and what are the possible results of grafting? Fusion is one of the things. So the results of close contact is fusion. So that's fused people, those are babies. Transitory fusion, that's when something will fuse for a short amount of time. They found that, especially with the Possilopora and those corals, is that they would tend to fuse up until about 9 months or 12 years of age, and then they would separate out their different tissues. And that's called transitory fusion, and you actually do get that quite a bit with grafting. Sometimes it only lasts a day or two, but that is transitory fusion. The soft tissue of the two corals will intermingle, the mesoglia will transport nutrients between the two of them. Cytotoxic and necrotic reactions, so that's a more extreme, so that's when things are starting not to work out, that's when they're starting not to get along. Formation of skeletal boundaries, so that's when, after they say, oh, I don't like you, it's an interesting reaction. It's actually not one coral killing the other coral, it's one coral killing itself to separate it from the other coral. So the first part of that reaction is to kill itself at that boundary, a couple cell layers deep, and then to form a skeletal boundary. So if you graft two together and they don't fuse, eventually they'll start to create these little whorls of extra skeletal material. Then overgrowth, one might try to overgrow the other one. Sometimes if you fuse some of these corals together and you get transitory fusion, one might start actually being more dominant over the other one. And again, this is actually size dependent, so you can't say, well, this coral is always going to overgrow this one, because it depends on how much bigger this one is than that one. So you can't make any general rules with that. And then death and stinging, this most extreme reactions. Like, you know, your echinophilia is going to like barf and eat all over your acropora if you have them too close together. You know, that's the ultimate thing. And you can't ever fuse. One's going to eat the other. People do stupid things sometimes. This is some of those experiments that were looking at fusion and grafting. So these are using very small pieces. It's interesting. Corals, especially when they're smaller, their immune system works differently, and it's a size, basically maturing immune system. So as they get older, they get less and less likely to want to fuse with other things, because their immune system becomes more robust. Here's closer. You can actually see the not only just like them growing next to each other, but the actual soft tissue is all one, you know, tissue net over that skeleton. All right, so this is we're getting into chimera. So chimera, there's hybrids. Hybrid is when you have one animal of species breed with another animal. A chimera is when you put two different animals together. So this is a jeep. This is a sheep and a goat mixed together. But when they put the embryos of a goat and a sheep together in the petri dish, and then if you look at it, it's got like some goat legs, got some sheep ears and different parts like that. Here's another chimera. This is actually a human ear growing on a mouse. Here's this crazy guy. He put an ear on his hand. It's actually grown out of his own tissue. Here's another thing. Crazy, taking DNA. This isn't fusion necessarily, but this is taking the DNA from corals and using them on science and mammals. So here's a glowing green mouse and glowing red cancer cells. Allows us to do real-time research. Here's a rat brain or a mouse brain, 32 different fluorescent proteins, and what this did is allow them to map neurons. So there's a lot of great science with that. Deaf gerbils, what they did is they took human stem cells and jammed them in these gerbils' ears after they'd already like ice picked them deaf, and they grew back the cells in order that they can grow. Humans are fused. This is a chimera. We're actually all chimeras. Explain that in a second. This is a chimera of two different pigmented embryo individuals fused in utero and then born as a person. Other vernacular is pretty funny. See, I'm getting up to 5 minutes here. Human double monster, used to be Siamese twins. I'm going to start blowing through this. We're all chimeras. We all have cells from our moms inside us, and our moms have our cells inside them. Helps us with immunology, stuff like that. So blah, blah, blah. Fish will fuse. I'm blowing through this now. These are my first inspirations that fusion happens, and it happens naturally. So that's a trachophilia, half and half. It's pretty fascinating. The tissues all fuse, and it's actually, you can see the mouth is mostly the green tissue and a little bit of the other one. This is a goniopora I received about a year later, and it was also fused, soft tissue. This wasn't just like, there was no boundary here, looking for that skeletal thing. And if you look at some of the polyps, they're half and half. It's pretty fascinating. Fusion breakthroughs. This is my first acath astrea canada, doing it on purpose. And you can see over time as it develops. First, it started with just that one little polyp there, right there. And then it started spreading throughout the colony. I'm going to show you a later slide with Thraustochytrids, which is crazy stuff about that. We did some science. So this is at a high school, and we did replicates. We wanted to see if all these different acans could fuse together, and we found, yeah, you know what, they do. So that's pretty cool. We were looking at it under microscopes. We wanted to see the transition in the different cell lines of one coral oozing into the other. We really wanted to prove that there's no skeletal boundary. Boom, done. So it happens. It's neat. Nature does it. Other people are doing it. Keep doing it. Goniopores are neat. I like doing crazy stuff. Goniopora. Everyone knows that goniopora like dirty, muddy water. But really, they are a coral, and they have minimal requirements. The way I look at goniopores are like an SPS. They're just a really big, puffy parietes. So like other SPS, they're going to want other, you know, the conditions that you're going to need to supply for that. They're not going to want a totally, you know, bombed out tank full of nutrients, although they probably want Rich Ross's tank full of nitrate and phosphate. Because he's doing pretty good with that. We'll get on to nutrient levels later, which will blow your mind a little bit. So it's not really an SPS. And then, you know, SPS, LPS, we were all getting sick of this. And there's, you know, MPS. I more consider an MPS. And the way I consider an MPS is like, you know, well, most LPS coral eat big stuff. They can handle big things. You know, they're not an SPS. And it's like it's a weird kind of group, but there's, you know, it's a smattering of all these different genera and families of corals. So it's all bunk, it's all crap, so don't listen to that. We're all making up all these terms, it doesn't, you know. But what will help you is just the basics of what you need to survive, what these corals need to survive, so you need to have the proper water parameters. Now, system design, there's we had a great talk with Jake and Julian about just all the different ways you can skin a cat. So, you know, protein skimmers, well, mostly I don't use them, but there's more than one way to skin a cat. When I first started growing goniopora, it was more just a happy accident. I was working at a retail shop. You know, you get your coral box, and one or two of them is a goniopora every time. I would just throw them in our display tank and not sell them because I, you know, was trying to develop an ongoing customer base. I'd rather get that guy in mushrooms and zoes and put him on a favia. But then it's like, oh, look at the tank. 2 years later, these goniopora are alive. And one of the things is I had a refugium. I wasn't skimming too much, and I did feed a lot of food. So then I started being like, all right, well, what is the thing that's helping me keep them alive, and can I reproduce that? And it was a lot of theories were going on around about different nutrients and stuff like that. I'll get into that a little bit. Iron does help, but food is such a really big major thing. So I went through species by species. I wanted to see what they did eat and whatnot. Make a long story short, there's all kinds of different foods you can feed them. I basically stumbled upon like rotifers, all these different zooplanktons and stuff, and then work with Julian to create GonioPower so that everyone can feed their goniopores very easily. But your system design, it's gonna make it, you know, if you don't have a refugium and you skim your tank a lot and you're doing all these things and you have beautiful, wonderful coral, you're probably gonna be able to keep goniopora for sure. Most of these ones that we're collecting now are from reef environments, so you're gonna do quite well with them. Stooksii, this is, you know, this slide is actually a little old, and this is becoming less and less true. 5 years ago and previous used to all be Stooksii, the common. And we all know the reds are easier, and now what's great about what's happening with the change in collection and what they're bringing in is like they're bringing all these new and interesting goniopora varieties, but they're also way more suitable for aquariums. There's 25 known species, there's way more than that. I can tell you I've seen twice as many go through my hands. There's a lot of diversity out there. But you know, it's only a couple of them really aren't great for your tanks. So identifications, you could do it like definitely completely, 100% by looking at the skeleton, but most of the time you're not gonna bleach it. Like there's like a little ghost in there. Like see right there? It's kind of freaky. It's Casper. I'm gonna blow through these. It's gonna show you some of the diversity of coral. There's, I'm only gonna have named in here probably like half a dozen or whatever, but you can see the, you know, palmensis is great. Pandoriensis is a branching form. Burgosii is a kind of encrusting mounding, very easy to keep. Stoochberii, one of the easiest. We have a Stoochberii complex, I like to call it, in the hobby, which I really think is like four or five different types of coral, but right now they're all known as Stoochberii because that's as far as everyone's gone with the identification. Little baby Burgosii's, family shot, palmensis, I think one of the most beautiful. One of the least likely to eat big chunks of food, seems to mostly eat bacteria and stuff. Tenuidens, the purples. This is fascinating. Our tenuidens normally grows in lagoons. Every once in a while, they get one off of fore reef. Looks completely different in the polyps and stuff, but it's the same animal. And it reacts differently. It's a totally different morphology. And it almost looks like planulata, but blue, but it's still this other guy. Fascinating. Planulata, this is like the ORAs, red goniopora, one of the easiest big puffiest goniopora that you can grow. I love this guy, it makes you feel good, they eat a lot. Norfolkensis, this is probably the best substitute for green goniopora, like a normal flower pot, very hardy. Australia is starting to pull a lot out. This is polyformis, only comes in like once every 2 or 3 years from Indonesia, but it's the super bright glowing green. I haven't seen it in the last couple of years, but I'm sure it's gonna come back around again. There's a guy in Germany that's growing tons of this species, grows well. Gibutiensis is a beautiful kind of blue, purple coral miner. They've been pulling it a lot. They can get along. General rules don't make them touch each other on their actual base, but their tentacles can intertwine. Here's little tiny pieces. I'm going on to the next subject. Hydrogen peroxide. So hydrogen peroxide, oxygen is poison. So a lot of catalase and peroxidase, enzymes that cells use to deal with oxygen. Oxygen's bad for you. Oxygen rips stuff apart. Oxygen is, Hulk Hogan is the peroxide ripping apart stuff. Hydroperoxide is a great tool, but you do have to handle higher concentrations with care. And now in this age, you can just go online and buy yourself 30% hydrogen peroxide. Well, the hydrogen peroxide that I'm going to use and recommend for all of you is just use the pharmaceutical grade 3%. That 30% stuff, you can really hurt yourself. You just get it on your hands. It dissolves away your fingertips. It's gross. You get it in your eyes, you'll go blind. So I do use it, but I'm very careful. Yeah, I want eye protection, hand protection. I only use it to dilute it. It was just cheaper to buy a big 5-gallon bale, and I'm still, it's a couple years, we still haven't gone through it all yet. And the way it destroys stuff is it goes all the way, it just jams right through all kinds of cells of any type. At the high enough concentration, it will overwhelm catalase and peroxidase enzymes that are breaking it down. So these are the tools of the trade. You can see a nasty hair-covered rock has some zoanthids and stuff on it. The same reason it's a good algae pretty bad is the reason it's a good algae killer. So algae doesn't have as much stuff. It also makes a great mouthwash at the lower percentages. But our immune cells use hydrogen peroxide. That's the tool that they're using on a molecular level when they want to destroy a pathogen and completely nuke it. They're using hydrogen peroxide. It's part of why vitamin C is important for us, for especially when you get a cold. What it's doing is priming all your immune cells so they have a whole bunch of hydrogen peroxide to use. So vitamin C is the precursor for hydrogen peroxide. It's important for you to have it. Fluorescent proteins are fascinating. Not only do they change the color of light, maybe they do something like that with the zooxanthellae, but they're also an antioxidant. And in fact, they're found in all kinds of deep sea creatures that have no contact with light, have nothing to do with light, and they function in those organisms like antioxidants. So they actually do help you with your peroxide treatments. They'll actually, with the coral itself, they'll handle some of that peroxide scrubbing. And we've been using barley bales in the freshwater industry for quite a while, same principle, but in freshwater. So at the Science Technology Magnet High School, where I had this lab, ran a nonprofit for a few years, we were doing a lot of like fun aquaculture research and curriculum development. We were doing the lab about the whole thing. It was like about peroxidase and potatoes. And I was like, well, you know, algae really doesn't really have peroxidase. We know plants do. What about corals? Corals have peroxidase? And it turns out they kind of do. But other guys can't handle it quite as well. So snails and mollusks, you got to be careful with that because they will hurt them. But it will kill nudibranchs. They're mollusks, so it actually helps quite a bit. So it's really good for quarantine dips. It gets rid of polyclads, flatworms. It's also good for bacterial infections and brown jelly infections. And I like it way better than iodine dip for brown jelly infection, because what will happen is that all the brown jelly and the rotting coral and all that mucus is going to float up. And that brown jelly is very contagious, and it's a complex of ciliates and bacteria and fungi, and they live as a kind of meta-organism, and it just spreads all over. So by using the peroxide, you actually lift it up, and you get it away from all the rest of the tissues on the coral that you're using it. So methods of application, you can apply it directly. You know, this is good for certain things that are very sensitive, so if you want to work around them, you don't, because, you know, basically the rules are, I'm going to start blowing through this, I'm getting too long here, is that SPS in general are more sensitive, so you want to be careful about not putting it on them. Another great thing is using a toothbrush, so you can kind of work around the coral and kind of work on the rock. Another method you could use is dosing, dipping it. So this is, you could do this at a higher concentration for algae dip control for more tolerant species. This is also a good technique to use at a lower concentration for bacterial infections or rotting deep inside the skeleton. Sometimes when a coral comes in from the wild, you'll look at it on the outside and then you smell it. It smells like rotten eggs. There's all this stuff rotting on the inside. But there's a whole host of bunch of organisms that were living in there, and then through collection and handling of the several weeks, that by the time it got to you, a lot of those boring sponges and all these different things have started dying. And that will slowly kind of rot its way up to the surface of your coral, and it'll start dying. You won't realize it. And you know, when you do a lot of fragging on coral, if you're going through a lot of coral, you'll see this in about a third of the coral. So doing a nice light dip in peroxide for a little bit will oxidize all that. So generally H2O2 tolerant corals, favids, echinopora a tiny bit, it's still a favid, but it's kind of, you know, to the chalice. Mucids are rather tolerant, exception is echinophilia, but scolemias, lobos, acans, blastos, they can handle quite a bit. So especially with a single polyp coral, if one of those bones gets, the ridges gets exposed, get algae on it, it's, you know, coral won't grow back. Ganiopore, I'm blowing through this. So this is kind of, you know, basically you work with more dilute solutions. Everyone can come up to me later and I can give them whatever info they want. And then, you know, before and after, hey, it works, look how clean it is. you notice how there's still all the crap there, all the actual, see the dead bryopsis? So often you have to physically remove it, but you know, you got crabs and stuff, and they'll go in and eat it. And sometimes you don't even have to completely kill it. It doesn't have to be white. It'll, you know, the stuff will come in afterwards. All right, so potassium dosing. Potassium dosing is awesome. So iodine has been hyped as critical for the growth of zooanthids. They're wrong. It's, you know, it doesn't do that. For me, you know, it's like I haven't been dosing iodine since I just started recently with this really cool iron manganese mix. But what it does for me is makes pest nudibranchs grow in my quarantine system. I've been growing zinnias with potassium solely for the last half a decade. So it does not prevent zinnia collapse. Iodine doesn't. It's potassium does. So why aren't we all doing it? So I had to credit Steve Garrett. Garrett's a cropolis. He really got me going on potassium. I was doing some aquaculture, large-scale aquaculture out there. We were working with the local water. He's like, well, you look at the potassium? I'm like, no, I didn't. Potassium was just horribly low. And he's telling me this story, and he's been like, well, I had this tank, and I was looking at my potassium. It seemed low, so I started dosing it. But then I looked at it, and I was doing the test wrong, and I realized I had double potassium. Everything actually looks better, so I kept it. And so I was applying those same principles in my aquaculture, and I regularly run my potassium 2 to 3 times regular levels. I made my thing. Normal levels. So this is a very interesting conversation that Rich was talking about with the phosphates and nitrates. So number one, why is he running all these crazy high levels, but his tank is great? It probably has a lot to do about these ratios. So why am I able to like completely triple my potassium and not have bad effects, and in fact have really good growth, really good color? I mean, that's why I'm doing it. I'm doing it because I want my corals to look pretty and grow fast. So our tanks generally have a lot more nitrogen and phosphorus than the wild. And there is natural variation on the reef from that, you know, 0.03 or 0.009 to 0.9. But, you know, we have high concentrations of 1.0 or 3.1 phosphate. So how can we get away with that? And then what else room does that leave us for all these other ions that we can play with? What is the ideal? This is just because the ocean has a certain calcium and ion ratio right now doesn't mean that, you know, corals weren't growing tens of millions of years ago when things were just a little bit different. And who says which part is better? What we're finding is like all these weird, wacky ratios we're starting to play with, and they're having good effects. So I think we can achieve similar ratios, which is natural seawater, with this nitrogen phosphorus. So in order, all right, so if we have double phosphorus and nitrogen than we have in seawater, why shouldn't we be able to double our potassium? We know this with plants is that we have a nitrogen phosphorus potassium ratio, and it's very important depending on the kind of plant that you're going to grow that you have that right ratio. I think we have the same thing that we're having in tanks, and we're playing with the same game here. So what I've done is just gone up with the potassium side of it, and I'm having a lot of fun with it. This guy does it too. So we first started doing it, it's like, well, we got to get this potassium in. It's like, all right, well, we did it. It's like a 3-day weekend came in, we were both like, wow, everything is really bright. So this is in our aquaculture system in the back. And Joe is really slow and methodical about everything. So in lightning speed, in several months, he turned around and did it. I know people are just like, oh yeah, I saw your hydroperoxide thing. A bunch of my tank, I bleached my tank. This guy is so like calm and cool about it. It takes him 2 years to decide for like a regime change. But this potassium is like the fastest thing I see him jump on. Now he does iron dosing too. And again, it's like he has much higher nutrient levels in his tank. We have a lot of other room to play with these ions. So it's you know, it works. So, but the thing is, you gotta take it slow. You gotta be careful because you can kill things and things will melt. In the beginning I did that, and there's a couple of species like Cyphastrian and stuff that would do it. Iron. For me, my two-part additive that I add on a regular basis is an iron supplement and then a potassium chloride supplement. And that's mostly it. I do the kalkwasser method. And then I supplement a couple times a week with like our, you know, normal calcium alkalinity two-part. But for me, the more important thing, what I'm finding as I get detriment to my growth when I am lax on my iron and potassium. So just food for thought. Thraustochytrids. Okay, these things are going to blow your mind. Again, this kind of came up in Rich's talk a little bit about the microorganism population in our aquariums. And everyone's saying bacteria this, bacteria that. It's mostly not even bacteria. It's mostly, there's a lot of it's these guys. That Labyrinthocytes is the larger group, and these Thraustochytrids, very hard to say. The short is going to be Thraustos. So when you talk to people, oh, yeah, zooxanthellae, we can roll off the tongue. Eventually, everyone will be saying Thraustochytrids. It'll be like, whatever. For now, you just call it Thraustos. But they're related to kelp, mildew, diatoms. They're just these little kind of fungus-looking things. We thought they were fungus up until, I don't know, what, 15 years ago. And they started doing like DNA analysis. They're mostly interested in them and where they live in the ocean, brackish environments, and the mud, that kind of stuff. They're important selling cue species for barnacles. So you know, you have biofilms, bacteria, and stuff like that. Well, it's actually a bunch of the things that are first settling out are these Thraustochytrids. We've been using this catch-all phrase of like bacterial biofilm and stuff, but a huge, huge portion of these microorganisms is actually this group of animals. Thraustos produce a large amount of fatty acids, including hoofa, poofa, moofa, DHA, blah, blah, blah. You know, you can make jet fuel out of that. It's 90% of the organisms living in the coral mucus is this. We've been saying, oh, there's bacteria living there, there's fungus living there, there's all this stuff. It's actually mostly these Thraustochytrids, this one group of animals. What got me going on it is I had a scientist buddy, and he was, you know, I've been growing these things in my closet for 2 years. I have these little fungia tissue samples, and they kept growing and growing. And all I was doing was changing a little bit of the water in the test tube once a week. So I went in and I tested the water before and after. And what he found was that there was sulfur was being depleted. So I took all these little guys out, and he started looking at them under the microscope, and he started seeing all these little projections. Those projections were the Thraustochytrids living intracellularly inside the coral cell. And they were cycling the sulfur and other elements from the seawater and producing B vitamins and stuff like that. So not only do they grow on the coral mucus, and they're 90% of the organisms there for a lot of the coral, they also live intracellularly, and they were growing inside the coral cell, and they have these projections called a brothosome. That sticks out into the water and actually has a different cell structure. The cell walls are different, and it is more permeable to different nutrients than the actual coral's own cells. Here's an example of a coral, like the fungia that we're just talking about, very highly associated with Thraustochytrids. Generally, corals that are really associated with sand or other substrates tend to have high populations of Thraustochytrids, and it's actually abundant sources of sulfur around there. Funny. Coral holobiont can be thought of kind of like a plant in the symbiotic relationship. So the zooxanthellae are like the chloroplasts doing the, you know, in the plant cell. It's just in the coral that they're two separate organisms. There's a symbiosis in a plant that happened millions and millions of years ago, so that now it's one cell. The Thraustochytrids are like the fungal mycorrhizae, the myco fungus that grows on plant roots. So this is what happens. Plant on the left has the fungal symbiont, the plant on the right does not. And you can see a huge difference in the development of the roots. Some of that white fiber is actually the fungus, and you can see the health of the plant is very, very heavily impacted. So this is actually, I was looking online, hey, can I get a diagram of what a Thraustochytrid looks like and what it looks like in a cell? No, there's not even at that point yet. There's probably like five guys that are even looking at this stuff in coral. But I did pull off a picture of a fungus, and it's basically what it is. So you have the Thraustochytrid cell inside the coral cell, and then it has these projections, much like these projections, that stick out into the water column, and then they process nutrients. It's pretty fascinating. So, all right, so Thraustos, this is kind of, you know, this whole color-changing thing and colors jumping around, and everyone has their theories about it. I'm pretty sure I'm right now. I had the five different theories before, too. Theory that some people are working on now is that it's Thraustochytrids. There's several different fluorescing Thraustochytrids, silvers and greens, and possibly with this jumping green, it's probably a Thraustochytrid. There we go. So what we have here is two different strains of the same clonal lineage of coral. One has been treated heavily with hydrogen peroxide, the other has just been happily chilling out. Now over time, they have different populations of Thraustochytrids, maybe zooxanthellae, but that shouldn't have an influence on any other colors in brown.
And then we started to get fusion. This is isogenic fusion. This is not allogenic because this was originally a clonal animal. However, it's just been treated differently. But here we can see right here at the fusion point that some of these pigments are going over. And probably what that is Thraustochytrids. So this is the green jacket or purple jacket acropora from Steve Garrett. This is jumping green color. Everyone's been trying to figure it out. Pretty darn sure it's Thraustochytrids. And starts propagating. So recently down in Belize, as part of our work that we're trying to do to research coral restoration, and I'm really interested in interactions between corals, so I came across a whole bunch of examples. And I was looking at this picture closer, and I was like, it kind of looks like where that color's mixing that, is it? But yeah, there's a single polyp there. So, and that whole colony, this is what I was talking about, there's transitory fusion, there's like long-term fusion. This also happens where you have just one spot fuses. And it's funny that it's fusing where the Thraustochytrid population is using onto the other colony. So this goes into coral immunology and the role that symbionts play and even the like who they will fuse with. So if you do want to have successful fusion, maybe you need to regulate the population of Thraustochytrids in the two organisms. So this actually has a lot of potential also with coral restoration. So what if there's different populations of Thraustochytrids that are going to make it a little bit hardier? You put these two corals together, you should also make sure they have the same population of Thraustochytrids to have a good outcome. So and the last topic, this is what I'm really excited about. We've been working really hard for quite a while. It's reef generation, St. Martin. So this is our crack team. We got Dr. Kaplan. He is probably... so many proteges in this hobby alone. He set up labs all over the world. He's written many of the Peterson's field guides that you guys have in your home and about seahorses and coral reefs. Got Todd Gardner, last year's Aquarist of the Year. He's a super awesome fish expert. Now, he's moved on from the aquarium. Now he's a professor full time, but he's always at the aquarium every day and still breeding fish. His former boss, Joe Waiulo, is a coral growing expert, my coral growing expert business partner, Laura Birenbaum. And we have a couple partners that are helping us out right now. Marco Rock is donating a bunch of the rock for us to create a reef. So what we're doing is we're starting off our project. We have a long-term goal, and then we have a four-phase project. But the first phase of our project is to build these artificial reefs in St. Martin. So one of these reefs is going to be a natural substrate made out of Marco rock, and then two little fishies providing all the glue and epoxies and supplies that we need to put the corals in. So this is going in, these reefs are going in the Caribbean in St. Martin. St. Martin, you can see, we're going to zoom up here. Beautiful little island, it's small. It's actually the smallest island split between two nations. On here you can see up in the upper right, this is the French side of the island on the north up here. So pretty much more than half of the French side of the island is a nature reserve. Our project is in a bay up right here, and we're right next to their reserve. So we're operating right outside the reserve, so we're kind of excited because we're helping to expand the area of influence that we can have with the conservation and protect all the endangered coral in that area too. And they're excited to work with us at the Nature Reserve, and we're talking about trading corals and with helping them out with their restoration. So there's several sites that we already have picked out. They are been decided because they're number one, easy to get to. Number two, they also are ideal for the coral species that we're transplanting in the area. Good flow, low sedimentation, protected from wave action. The Nature Reserve is starting their artificial reef project. They're using these cinder blocks and stuff like that. We're going to use a couple different methods. One, we're going to have a more natural rock structure. Then we're going to use a concrete structure more analogous to kind of like the bio balls, but not like in a ball shape. But and then we're going to do a PVC rack system for more intensive farming. But one of the things that is exciting about the project is that down there is a beautiful piece of property. It's 85 acres, and what we're hoping for is that we're gonna be able to long-term for this project, after we get everything going in the ocean, is that we're going to get this project developed as our second half of our restoration. So they have a beautiful property here. They have every species of mangrove, and it's one of the few sites on the island that actually has all four species of mangrove. It's on a saltwater pond, and it's a pond where 66 different species of migratory birds, many of them endangered, actually winter over in this pond. So the property is right on the edge of this. And we're going to work with our friends over at the Nature Reserve. This is part of one of their properties, their mangrove walk that they have. It's an educational walk, and there's gene reading, the thing. And it's a little, you can see the little thing, you can watch the birds so that people can look at the migratory birds. So well, we're really excited about this project, and what sets it apart a little bit from CRF and C-Core is that we're going to look more at the LPS coral. We are going to work really closely with CRF and all of them. We're really excited about the work they do, but we also see a need for these other species of coral to be worked with. And in fact, when St. Martin in this area, it does have a very, very low amount of these acropora. So we were going to work very hard to make sure those colonies that are there, we're talking only like half a dozen, you know, in a 10-mile area. So we're going to work really hard to make sure those are cared for. They're very small now, but we hope to get them, you know, if we can keep them alive for the next 10 years, to get to mature size. However, we have a plethora of all these other coral species that are also important. The coral cover in the Caribbean used to be upwards of 60% or more, and it would have up to 62 to 65 different species on one reef. And you're not going to find that anywhere in the Caribbean at all anymore. Maybe a spot or two in Belize, but it's still, the diversity is way down from what it was. We are at the point now in our industry where we can grow these corals economically, easily, and quickly. We can take a coral fragments, and we do it all the time in our tanks, and we see all how fast we grow these. If you take care of a coral, we can kind of cheat. So it generally takes a LPS coral about 12 years, 15 years to reach sexual size in the ocean. But we can cheat in captivity because we can provide optimal environments, we can provide lots of substrate, it can grow on really quickly, and then we can create this whole, we do the isogenic fusion, take the same clonal line, and then put it back together, and then you get yourself a foot wide coral in a few years. And then you can put it back on the reef, and then it can spawn. Because all spawning and all that, as far as the coral is concerned, it's like, I have this much surface area, so I'm a big boy now, I can do my thing. There's lots of life there. Every Tuesday in that town, they have this great thing, and the ladies dance down the street. It's a lot of fun. There's a huge diversity of coral in the Caribbean, and we do have the ability now. It's been overlooked. People thought it was tough, but we can do it. This is an example of us doing it for on our side. This is, you know, they're starting to fuse, you know, in another year this thing will just be a few, you know, a huge, you know, foot and a half wide just single coral. Local buy-in is really important, so that's why we're at a point now in this project where we think that we can bring it to you as our industry. We have our buy-in in St. Martin. We have all the most important players and the political and business and even just the local community really excited about this project. So the Nature Reserve, they're in charge of pretty much 30% of the land and almost all the water in St. Martin and managing that. And as we all know about conservation people, they tend to be hands-off. They're very, very, they don't like the idea of saying fragging and breaking things. We're best buds. They totally want us to do this. I don't know how we sold it to them, but we just kept having great meeting after great meeting that whole week with all the different partners. So they're very much looking forward to us bringing our coral know-how to their projects. This is the wonderful family that, again, we just keep getting tickled. Gene was like, you know what, the one day you're gonna remember is this night. So this family has the 85 acres that they are working on developing the property. And this is what is gonna make or break any project, no matter where you go. That's why some of these mariculture things in Indonesia, the whole cardinal tetra collection that they, you know, where the local villages saved the whole watershed basically, it's local buy-in. You know, it's like you have everyone involved. It's what we want to do down there will eventually help everyone, and everyone knows it, and everyone wants to help. So now we're coming to you as an industry to say, you know, so we have our Indiegogo campaign that we have up now. So we just, if you got $5, if you get $10, throw it at us. What it's going to show the people that have the really, really big pockets and actually make stuff happen. You know that, oh, you guys know what's going on. You think that we're ready to do this. and then we get all the, you know, we got the local people, we got all these resources. Now we just need to just push it over the edge, and then, you know, we want to do good, all the wonderful things that we've gotten out of this industry and the hobby, and all the potential that we have, we want to bring that to the rest of the world. And we also think that it's going to help our image as an industry. Colin Ford and all the press that he got for that, all that great work in Miami, that was a coup for public relations for our hobby. And it's it can only get better. And we've had some pretty serious talks about the potential of what our industry getting shut down, and it's all the PR game. But I'm just excited that we've gotten to this point now in our hobby where the PR is turning around, and there's multiple projects like coral restoration at Sea Core, and now we're doing this thing. You know, it's just like, it's a good time. And so I want to thank MACNA, I want to thank Jake, I want to thank everyone that came out here. It was great partying with you. Please ask me questions, at any time. You can look me up online. I'm happy to answer anything. So thank you.